Good morning to all. Welcome to online class. Today I am Rukma Ruchand is going to teach class 11th biology, and the chapter is second chapter and part 2 of biological classification. In part 1, if you remember, we have done the first kingdom, that is kingdom Monera, which possess the characteristics of prokaryotes and unicellular forms. So they are entirely kept in a separate kingdom, all the bacteria and all the similar type of organisms which do not have a well-defined nuclear membrane. Today we are going to study the next kingdom according to our plan of study, that is Protista. Now the two main characteristics of this Protista kingdom is, these are the two main important characteristics. The first is unicellular and the second is eukaryote. Now unicellular means, uni means one and cell means, as we know, for each, if the organism is made up of a single cell, it is called as unicellular. Similarly, we have another important property of the Protista kingdom, and that is eukaryote. U means a new, something which is new, and karyon means nucleus. So it makes a modified nucleus which we call, and in this we find, suppose this is a cell and this is the genetic material, nuclear material, and the nucleolus. If it is surrounded by a proper definite membrane, it is called as a nucleoid, and this is what makes the organism eukaryote. So a eukaryote is that cell which has a well-defined membrane around its nuclear material. So that is the basic, you can say, classification on the basis of kingdom Monera, which we have done in the previous class, and kingdom Protista. Now kingdom Monera also have unicellular organisms, but they were prokaryotes, means their genetic material was not surrounded by the nuclear membrane. But when it is surrounded by a nuclear membrane, it becomes a well-defined nucleus, and then the organisms which have both these properties comes under the kingdom Protista. Now these are the four categories that we see here. Some of the examples you must have seen, you must have studied from your lower classes, and they belong to, one of the first examples you can see is Chlamydomonas. The second one is amoeba. The third one is paramecium, which we also call it as slipper animalcule, and then euglena. Now these are the four very common examples that we see around us. You have been seeing in the textbooks of your lower classes also. Now we have divisions of kingdom Protista. Okay, so first we start with the first kingdom Protista classification. Under this we have the first category, which are strictly photosynthetic protists. Photosynthetic, as the name itself says, they are capable of synthesizing their own food. Okay, and for that they need chlorophyll. So that is the main characteristic feature here, that they need a chlorophyll, and that's what makes them a photosynthetic protist. Under this we also call them as, commonly they are called as protistan algae. Now they are not algae. Algae are organisms which belong to plant kingdom. But here we find that these organisms, they belong to protistan. The reason is because they are single-celled organisms. So they cannot be considered as plant. But because they have the characteristics of algae, that means they possess chlorophyll in them, this is the reason why they are called as photosynthetic protists, or commonly called as protistan algae. Now under this protistan algae, we have classified them into three types. The first is chrysophyte, second is dinoflagellate, and the third is euglenoid. So we will take up one by one each group that is being under the classification of photosynthetic protist. Yes, we have the first category, chrysophyte, which are protistan photosynthetic types. Their general characteristic, as I told you, that all possess chlorophyll. So they have distinct types of chlorophyll. In the first chrysophyte, we have chlorophyll A and C. Apart from that, they have fucoxanthin and a carotenoid pigment. So these are the four main characteristic pigments that are found in the chrysophyte. And that's what makes them different from the other groups. Another important point is they store food as fat, oil, and a polysaccharide. This is a very important point. A polysaccharide compound is a form of the stored condition which is called as laminarin. So laminarin is nothing, it is just a stored form of the polysaccharide component found in the chrysophyte. So these are the two main characteristic features that we have to study under the group chrysophyte of the protistin photosynthetic type. Some of the examples that are given here are diatoms, golden brown, algae, we call them generally as I told you. Desmids is the other name, biologically we call them as desmids, but commonly it is called as golden brown algae. And also we have yellow green algae, it depends upon the type of chlorophyll pigment found on them. Now this is a picture of a few of the diatoms that you can see. Diatoms, you can say, occupy a major surface of the marine water, also on the earth's surface. And we find here, these are the general structures, as you can see, they are of the diatoms and other chrysophyte. The next category, children, we have is the dinoflagellates. Now, these are also unicellular marine forms. The previous ones were spread throughout the world, or you can say all over the landmass. Here we are only restricted to the marine part. And their cellulosic cell wall. Now the cell wall is made up of cellulose, which is further divided into plates. Plates means one like wall-like formation they have, and one over the other, and that gives them an armored appearance. Now you must have seen in the history that how the people used to wear armor in order to when they go for the battle or something, so to protect themselves from the attack of the animals. Now these armors were like plates, or they were heavy metallic elements. Same way we find here, these dinoflagellates also, they have plate-like formations of their cellulosic cell wall. So it is not just a simple wall around them, but they are in the form of plates that gives them an armored appearance. Now the chief pigments are chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B. And also we have carotenoids. The example is goniolics. So these are the general characteristics as well as the example of the dinoflagellates. Now as you can see here, you have the diagram of one of the dinoflagellates, and you can see their wall is like an armor. It looks like a shield to protect. So that completes the dinoflagellates and chrysophyte. The third category is the euglenoid. You must have heard the name of Euglena, and based on the name of Euglena only, the category is known as euglenoid. The very characteristic feature in these organism is that if you take the example of Euglena, you will find that they have a cell membrane. The outer membrane is the cell membrane. And this cell membrane is not surrounded by a cell wall. Okay, that is why I told you that it is not a plant. Okay, it's not considered under the plant category. The reason is because they have the outermost cell membrane, which gives an in-between appearance of plant as well as the animal. So sometimes we get confused whether they belong to animal category or plant. So we call them as a link between plant and the animal. The reason is because of the presence of this cell membrane. So they are considered as similar to that of the animals. Now, they have a pellicle. Pellicle is a membrane, or you can say a tough membrane, which surrounds the cell membrane. It is not a cell wall, but it does the function of providing flexibility to the organism. So you can see the Euglena moves in a very beautiful manner. They can change a little bit of their shape form. It is because of the presence of this pellicle. So pellicle is present instead of the cell wall. Second is cytoplasm. If we talk about the central part, we have the cytoplasm, which surrounds the nucleus of the cell. Now this has two reasons. One is the ectoplasm. If you see the outer region of the cell cytoplasm, you'll find that it has only outer dense ectoplasm, as you can see here. So this outer region, which I have lined out with a chalk, and that is representing the ectoplasm. Means it is also a cytoplasmic content, but it is more jelly-like, more dense. Whereas the inner region is more diluted form, or you can say more watery, and therefore we find that more fluid it can provide, or fluidity it can provide. So we have two regions of the cytoplasm. One is the ectoplasm, and the innermost is the endoplasm. You can break the name from the cytoplasm. Plasm here, ecto means outer, endo means inner plasm. The third very interesting property is that they possess contractile vacuole for osmoregulation. Now, osmoregulation means if these are marine organisms, so then they collect large amount of water inside. So what happens? That has to be thrown out from their body. And that is easily done by the process of a structure which is performed by contractile vacuole. So contractile vacuoles are present in them. They look like star-shaped structure, and they help to collect all the water, extra water that is present in the cell body, and allow them to go out. Along with it, we find that this is a type of excretion, also we can say, a very simple form of excretion seen in unicellular organisms. Coming to the next point, we have many important and interesting points in euglenoids. So we have the fourth point, stigma present. Stigma is a very small point on the, you can say, the cavity which we have here, which is represented as the mouth. Here we have a point, a spot called as stigma. This stigma which we have is allowing the light to be absorbed. That means the light, it is photoreceptive, it receives the sunlight. The last is the myonemes. Now, myo word is always related to the muscles. So, myonemes are present. They are actually surrounding the entire cell like this overall, and we find they entirely cover. They are muscle fibers, a very simplest form of the muscle fibers they are, and they entirely surround the cell of the body. And this way, they cause a more flexibility to the organism for its movement. So these are the general points of the euglenoids. And then we have the characteristic example of euglena, as you can see in the diagram, a very beautiful diagram we have. And you can see this is the mouth cavity, which we call, like we have a mouth for taking inside the food. Similarly, they have a cavity by which they allow the food to enter inside. So this is called as the cytopharynx. As you can see, it is the opening region of the mouth. Then we have the opening is called as the cytostome. Then the inner region is called as the cytopharynx, like we have a pharynx. Similarly, we have they have a short flagellum. As you can see, a budding of flagellum is there. And the complete flagellum, which is running down. You can see a big flagella is there, but there is only one flagella in the organism, single flagella. Coming to the next category, I was talking about the contractile vacuole. You can see there are some contractile vacuoles present here as labeled here. These are the contractile vacuoles, and you can see the orange color patches that are shown. They are nothing. They are just the chloroplast. So as you can see, the chloroplasts are surrounding everywhere. And similarly, we find that myonemes, as I told you, all the linings, these are the muscle fibers actually, or fibrils rather. Okay, the simplest form, which surrounds the entire organism and allow them in more flexible movement. Then other than that, we have so many structures that you don't have to study in detail. Only that you have to study the general area from which the food is being ingested. Then the flagella, a single flagella for locomotion. Myoneme for the muscular contraction and the movement of the body. Yes, we have a nucleus, very important part, the main controller of all the metabolic activities. A single nucleus is present, and you can see they have a well-defined membrane, as you can see in the diagram. This makes them eukaryote. So this is one of the category of the, you can say, photosynthetic protists, which have all the characteristics based on the plant. Now, what is the similarity with the plant? That they have chloroplast. What is the similarity with the animal? Because they have only cell membrane. They lack cell wall. So they have a link. They can form a link between plants and the animal cell. The next category we have is the flying mold. So we have finished with the protistant types, which were photosynthetic in nature. That means they were all capable, right from chrysophyte to dinoflagellates. Okay, all of these organisms, they had well chlorophyll pigments in them, chloroplast is there. But here we come to those category where we have slime mold. Now mold, usually we use the word for the fungi. The organisms which cannot prepare their own food, but they are dependent on other organisms. Basically, the dead and decaying matter we are talking about. Okay, so they depend on other organisms, and for that they are called as consumer decomposer protists. So they are consumers also, because they consume the ready-made food from the surrounding. Decomposer because they also, while doing this process, they are also decomposing the surrounding waste or the unwanted things in the surrounding that are present. So this makes them a very useful component in the environment. That is, they are consumer, at the same time decomposers, protist. The very important thing is that they lack chlorophyll. Now, the most important characteristics in them, they are saprophytic, the same thing. They are dependent on dead and decaying matter for their food. They have amoeboid body. Their body is amoeba shape. They can change their shape according to their movement or direction of the ectoplasm and endoplasm. Examples are Physarum and Dictyostelium. The next category we have is the protozoan protists. Protozoan protists are a little different from the previous ones, that is slime mold and the photosynthetic protists. In this we have the first category, that is flagellated protozoan. Here, these flagellated protozoan, the name itself says they bear flagella. So they are categorized in the category of flagellated. And the examples are Trypanosoma and Giardia. The second category is amoeboid. Amoeboid means which have the category of amoeba shape. You have already studied the structure of amoeba. Amoeba has a structure which we call it as the shape, as you can see, it can change the direction anywhere it can go. The arms can extend to any side, and the result is that they keep extending to one side or the other side. So here we find that these amoeboid protozoans which are there, the examples are amoeba, and their main locomotory part is the pseudopodia. These are the false foot or pseudopodia present in them. The third category is the sporozoans. They are the parasitic form. Parasitic means they live on other living organisms. Now, saprophytes are different because they live on dead and decaying matter. Parasites, they live on other living organisms. So, they include Plasmodium. As we all know that Plasmodium is one of the organisms which is responsible for causing malaria and many more problems to the body. Then the last category is ciliated protozoa. As the name itself says, ciliated. So they bear cilia, they are also commonly called as ciliate. So most of them are based on their names only. The example is Paramecium. So we have flagellated protozoan, amoeboid, sporozoan, and then we have the ciliated. Now you can see the example of Trypanosoma. It is the first category, that is the flagellated one. Then we have the amoeba, as you can see here. This is the amoeboid category. Okay, I told you that they have pseudopodia extensions, and they have cell membrane as the outermost membrane, contractile vacuole, nucleus, everything is present in the same manner. They too have ectoplasm and endoplasm. Then we have Plasmodium, which are strictly parasite forms. They do not have any locomotory structure because they have to depend on the other living body. So they need a host or the living organism body for their survival and growth. And the last category is the ciliate. As you can see, this is a slipper-shaped organism, also known as slipper animalcule or paramecium. Now, in this you see that they have been surrounded by hair-like bristles around them, and these are called as the cilia. They are the hair-like structure, and they beat together like the oath, you must have seen during the Onam festival that how the people row the oars, okay, all together so that the boat goes ahead. In the same manner, the cilia also waves. Okay, their movement is in the same manner, all together in one direction so that the organisms can take part in locomotion. So I hope, children, you have taken interest in this topic and I hope you have understood it well. In the coming topics, we will be taking up the next part of the chapter. Thank you and have a nice day.